In 2004, Bravo released a five-part documentary miniseries called The 100 Scariest Movie Moments, in which they count down, well... This turned out to be an influential series for me, since I wasn't allowed to watch more than a handful of R-rated movies before the early 2000s, so it wound up introducing me to a lot of famous horror films that I'd only known previously by reputation, or VHS cover art. These were the days before YouTube, before you could just look up kill count videos for literally every single horror film ever made. This was probably the very first time I ever saw real, live, actual footage of Chucky, Leatherface, Brundlefly, Annie Wilkes, and many, many more. But there was one high-ranking film on the list, all the way at number 15, that I hadn't even heard of. Freaks. Freaks? I never saw that at Blockbuster. How old is this movie? 1932? That's older than the Hollywood production code. It's in black and white. How scary could it possibly be? Oh. Oh. Oh no.
What the fuck?
And this isn't even the most notorious scene in the film. That would be the infamous Gooble Gobble sequence.
The one of us.
Gooble Gobble, Gooble Gobble.
We accept her, we accept her.
Gooble Gobble, Gooble Gobble.
One of us.
One of us.
Gooble Gobble.
This is The Popular Legacy of Freaks, an exceptionally twisted horror film of apotheotic bad taste, a profoundly disturbing sideshow spectacle that vaults over the line separating the merely macabre from the truly tasteless, a film of such shockingly vile real-world perversity that it rightfully ended the career of its director and prompted such a harsh rebuke from audiences that the film was quickly pulled from theaters and the original camera negative dumped to the bottom of San Francisco Bay, to be forgotten the world over for the rest of recorded history. All of which is dead wrong. Freaks isn't some waking nightmare. In fact... Part 1. The Road to Freaks. First things first, it's not like Freaks was simply unleashed on some poor unsuspecting public back in 1932. You'll hear talk of people running from the theater in terror, there's even one report of a miscarriage. But not only are these stories probably highly exaggerated, they all come from test screenings, not paid theatrical engagements, where people bought tickets very much on purpose for this particular film. Freaks was pre-sold, produced, and premiered within a very specific cinematic ecosystem to fulfill a very specific role within the international film market. That it was largely misunderstood by its contemporaries is not the film's fault. But let's talk about that ecosystem for a bit. Let's talk about the road that led to Freaks. In the wake of World War I, film suddenly got a lot more macabre. I don't know if the product created the demand or if the demand created the product, but with the advent of special makeup effects and audiences suddenly willing to watch them, the 1920s saw a dramatic increase in the frequency and prominence of films about death, disfigurement, and deformity. In 1920, barely a year and a half after the armistice, Lon Chaney starred in The Penalty, which tells the story of a young boy who's admitted to the hospital after being hit by a car, only for his negligent doctor to then amputate his legs without cause. The boy overhears the doctor and his supervisor coming up with an excuse to tell his parents, but when he tries to call them out on it, they hand wave away his accusations as effects of the ether. The boy then grows up to become the ruthless crime lord Blizzard, who seeks revenge on the incompetent doctor by hatching a wild plan to woo his daughter, amputate the legs of said daughter's fiancé, have those legs grafted onto his own body by the doctor who had originally amputated his own legs, and then force the daughter to marry him on pain of death. After which he promises to become a model son-in-law. But when he finally goes under the knife, the doctor operates not on his legs, but on a lesion at the back of his head, which instantly transforms him into a penitent do-gooder, whereupon he's quickly murdered by his former associate so as to prevent him from squealing on him. Whew. It's actually slightly less bonkers in context, since most of the film focuses on Blizzard's plan to lure all the police away from the city center and then ransack it with the help of an army of goons, with the subplot about getting revenge on the Doctor only really coming to the forefront in the final reel. It's still a doozy, though. In order to play the lead role, Lon Chaney famously refused to employ any camera trickery, opting instead to tie his lower legs back with a series of straps and then insert his knees into two leather buckets, a process which reportedly caused him a tremendous amount of pain. And it's no wonder. The public loved it. Hats off to Lon Chaney! As Blizzard, he gives one of the screen's greatest performances. Lon Chaney portrays a role that might have been written for him. It is needless to say that the picture is Chaney more than anyone else. Rarely has the screen seen a better piece of acting. Hell, even the 2012 Blu-ray includes a quote from Chaney's biographer about how the pain must have been a contributing factor to his performance. One has to wonder if the intensity Lon brought to this role might have been due in part to the pain produced by his harness. For what it's worth, I call bullshit. If you need to cause yourself literal pain in order to deliver a pained performance, you are not a great actor. You're not even an actor at that point. Now, I do think Chaney's performance is good, but I don't think it has anything to do with the peg legs. I just think he's wonderfully expressive. Here, look, this is the one shot of the film that actually made me wince, when Blizzard slides down a fire pole and lands on his knees. Oof, I'd have had to ice him down for days. But is the pain contributing to his performance here? I don't think so. He looks pretty happy to me. But with so much attention and adoration paid to Chaney's body transformation, it's no wonder he kept going. He soon garnered the nickname the Man of a Thousand Faces, and quickly popularized our modern notion of method acting, with countless roles in which he appeared under heavy makeup. His two most famous performances, as Quasimodo in the 1923 adaptation of The Hunchback of Notre Dame, and the eponymous Phantom in the 1925 adaptation of The Phantom of the Opera, both saw him acting under heavy makeup that reportedly caused him great discomfort. The Hunchback prosthesis weighed 45 pounds, and the Phantom of the Opera nosepiece caused him frequent nosebleeds. At the same time that Lon Chaney was making a name for himself in body transformation melodramas, director Todd Browning was creating a series of films that prominently featured disfigurement and deformity. Browning was in his element here, having literally run away to join the circus at age 16, and he only moved to Hollywood in his early 30s after he was discovered by fellow Kentuckian David Wark Griffith, who... Wait, D.W. Griffith? Browning directed several modest successes throughout the early 20s, including a few that starred Lon Chaney, but it was in 1925, when the two men moved from Universal to MGM, that their collaboration suddenly became a cottage industry. And I mean like the eight films they made together over the next 5 years have their own subsection on Wikipedia. And what's worth noting here is that every single one of these films contains some element of disguise, disfigurement, disability, or deformity. And sometimes all four. First, they made The Unholy Three in 1925, which tells the story of three ex-carnies, a ventriloquist, a dwarf, and a circus strongman, plus the ventriloquist pickpocket ex-girlfriend, who form an underground jewelry racket which quickly escalates to murder. Chaney plays a ventriloquist who disguises himself as an elderly grandmother, and then throws his voice so as to convince customers at a local pet shop that the parents can talk. Like you do. When the parrots inevitably stop talking in their new homes, the angry owners call Chaney, who then gains access to their home so that he can case the joint. He brings along with him the vicious Tweedledee, a dwarf disguised as his infant grandson to help run interference. Harry Earls plays Tweedledee, the same actor who'd go on to play the lead role in Freaks 7 years later. This one ends with Chaney giving testimony in court on behalf of a falsely accused defendant by throwing his voice at the witness stand while his two accomplices are torn to pieces in a remote cabin by a bloodthirsty gorilla, played by a chimp on a scaled set. If you haven't seen this one yet, I highly recommend the $10 blind buy. In 1926, Browning and Chaney made The Blackbird, in which Chaney plays a disfigured missionary. Chaney then wore a painful set of shark-like dentures in 1927's London After Midnight. And in 1928, Browning directed Chaney as two different characters under heavy makeup in West of Zanzibar. All three films were hits. In 1927, they also made The Unknown, which tells the story of... You know what, maybe you better sit down for this one. Alonzo is a small-time crook who binds his arms to his body so that he can hide out in the local circus while the heat dies down. While performing knife tricks as Alonzo the Armless, he falls in love with his assistant, Nanon, played by a pre-superstardom Joan Crawford. Nanon has a chronic fear of being touched by men, owing to an implied history of physical abuse at the hands of her father. Eventually, Alonzo decides that his love for Nanon is so strong that he decides to amputate his arms for real so that he can be with her. But by the time he recovers from surgery, Nanon no longer has a fear of being touched and is engaged to the resident circus strongman. Oh no. Oh no. Oh no, 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 no. which is especially poetic since Alonzo had previously encouraged the strongman to get grabby with Nanon specifically so that she'd reject him. But then the strongman learned about consent, gave Nanon some much-needed space, and agreed to wait until she was ready to receive his affections before trying to pursue her again. And in a fit of jealous rage, Alonzo tries to have the strongman's arms torn off by horses, only for the plan to backfire and get himself killed instead. By far my favorite bit of trivia about this film is that it was considered lost for several decades, until it was finally rediscovered in a French film library, in a stack of unidentified films that were all labeled unknown. The film went on to become one of the biggest hits of Chaney and Browning's careers. This isn't even an exhaustive list of all the body horror melodramas that Browning and Chaney made during the 1920s. These are just their collaborations. They were both making other body horror melodramas on the side, not to mention the influx of German expressionist horror coming in from overseas. Don't sleep on 1920s horror, it was a hell of a decade for the genre. But even after the success of films like The Unholy Three and The Unknown, we still weren't at the point where freaks could get made yet. One more thing had to happen first. In 1930, Universal acquired the film rights to a popular stage adaptation of Dracula, and studio boss Carl Laemmle Jr. greenlit the project with but one condition, that Lon Chaney play the title vamp. But then in June of that year, Chaney was diagnosed with throat cancer and he passed away within 2 months. Lots of actors subsequently screen tested for the role, but it eventually went to little-known Hungarian actor Bela Ferenc Dezső Blaszko. I'm not sure about the pronunciation there. Better known by his stage name, Bela Lugosi, who had originated the role on stage. Browning is credited with having directed Dracula, but most contemporary reports say that he was barely involved, leaving most of the day-to-day decision-making up to his cinematographer, Carl Freund. Despite the sudden death of its prospective star and the somewhat troubled production history, Dracula was a massive critical and commercial success, really the critical and commercial success of the 1930s. Personally, I think it's disappointingly brief, hilariously anticlimactic, and I couldn't identify the protagonist if you put a gun to my head. But it earned $50,000 in just 48 hours, at the height of the Great Depression, no less. And so after more than 10 years of development, the stage was finally set. MGM saw what Universal had done with Dracula and decided they wanted their own horror mega hit, and so they hired Browning to direct the ultimate horror picture. MGM had purchased the rights to the short story Spurs in 1929, which tells the story of a woman who marries a circus dwarf under false pretenses and is then punished for her deception, and Browning quickly selected it as his next project. According to film historian David J. Scall, early in the pre-production process, scriptwriter Willis Goldbeck showed producer Irving Thalberg a treatment for Freaks. After reading it, Thalberg reportedly dropped his head into his hands. "I asked for something horrifying," he groaned, "and I got it." Part 2. The Plot Proper. Freaks opens on Cleopatra, a beautiful high-wire trapeze artist who's being lovingly admired— Wait, go back. Damn it, I always forget that this isn't the actual first shot of the movie. The real first shot is this carnival barker guiding a group of tourists through a circus sideshow. And when he brings them to this one exhibit, from there we transition to the shot of Cleopatra on a swing. She's being lovingly admired from afar by a dwarf named Hans, whose attention is a little too thirsty for his fiancée Frida's liking.
"She's the most beautiful big woman I have ever seen. Why, Hans, how you talk. I should be jealous pretty soon."
Hans insists he's only got eyes for Frida, but it's clear from everything else he does that he's completely smitten with Cleopatra. For her part, Cleopatra's happy to lead Hans on, even though she has no real interest in him, either personally or romantically. She's interested in Hercules, the resident circus strongman, which seems to be a running theme in Browning's work. Frida tries multiple times to convince Hans that Cleopatra isn't interested, but Hans can't be swayed.
"For you, she cannot bring happiness. Ah, Frida, you don't know."
Throughout the first act, we also get brief introductions to all the other members of the circus. There's Josephine Joseph, the so-called half-woman, half-man, who's never actually seen performing, but whose costume is highly suggestive. Although I couldn't begin to tell from just the legs which side is meant to suggest which gender. Then there's John Eckhart Jr., who performs under the stage name Half-Boy, and Venus, the amenable seal trainer. That's not her stage name, though. That's just my description of her. She's literally an amenable seal trainer. Johnny and Venus are good friends with Frozo the clown, who makes a point of being an absolute sweetheart to every single person he meets.
"Oh, let's see, what a pretty dress. Oh, how beautiful you look tonight.
Then there's Olga the Bearded Lady, Peter the Human Skeleton, and Frances O'Connor, who was billed as the Armless Girl. Prince Randian plays the Human Caterpillar, Minnie Woolsey plays the Bird Girl, and then there's conjoined twins Daisy and Violet Hilton. Daisy's married to Roscoe, who is himself a grab bag of performative quirks, but Violet can't stand him and they're always butting heads.
Oh, come on, Daisy.
Oh, no, you don't. She's gonna stay right here.
No, she isn't. I gotta go.
Oh, boy, you're always using that for an excuse, for an alibi.
Some performers don't have any credited stage names, like Angelino and his wife Martha. And then there's a quartet of performers whose only trait they all have in common, as far as I can tell, is that they all just look different. Like, some of them have a specific congenital condition known as microcephaly, but not all of them. But anyway, they're all grouped together. Not every one of these introductions goes very far, like some of them are literally just a couple of shots, but they help build a sense of what day-to-day life in the circus is like.
Come on! Come on, Venus! The bearded lady's baby's born!
Eventually, Frida pulls a Jolene and asks Cleopatra herself to stop flirting with Hans so that he'll come back to her.
I know you just make fun. But Hans, he does not notice. If he finds out, never again will you be happy.
Now at this point, Cleopatra's already figured out that Hans has a little money, after he gifts her some jewelry. But it's in this conversation that Frida confirms that Hans has actually inherited a small fortune.
He has told you of the fortune he has inherited.
So now Cleopatra has an economic incentive to keep up the ruse. And in fact, Hans and Cleopatra are already married in the very next scene, with poor Frida heading the table at the wedding feast. And it's at this banquet where several important things happen. First, Cleopatra gets drunk, mocks Hans, and openly flirts with Hercules. Not a good start. But then, despite her flagrant contempt for the proceedings, the other performers decide to accept Cleopatra into the group as one of their own, and pass around a loving cup for everyone to drink from while chanting. But when the cup finally reaches Cleopatra, she realizes she doesn't even want to pretend to like these people anymore. She then puts Hans on her back and carries him around like a child while the other performers file out of the tent in shame and dismay. Wait, what's this? Okay, a lot happens in this scene. Cleopatra pours poison into Hans's drink and then serves it to him before everything goes sideways. After the party, Cleopatra goes to Hans's trailer to try and apologize, at which point Hans sort of acknowledges that their romance is a sham.
Always, I should have known you would only laugh at me.
And then he collapses from the poison. But it doesn't kill him. He becomes bedridden, but everyone in the circus knows he's being poisoned, and it doesn't take long for them to catch Cleopatra red-handed.
What's this?
Give me that little black bottle.
Cleopatra then tries to escape in the rain, while Hercules runs to Venus's trailer to try and kill her for knowing too much about the plot to kill Hans. But the other performers get the drop on her. And while Hercules tries to crawl away, the others close in, intent on eliminating the threat that he poses. Meanwhile, there's one final shot of Hans and the gang closing in on Cleopatra. She screams, and then we cut back to the opening scene, where we finally see what everybody's been staring at. It's Cleopatra. Or at least it used to be. Her legs have been severed, her face disfigured, and her body permanently transmogrified into the cruel parody of a bird. So, open and shut case, right? I mean, it sure sounds like a horror to me. Where else would you put this one if not the horror section? Well, I for one think that'd be a great way to categorize it. Incorrectamundly. Hi, Tommy. Part 3. Whose idea of horror? Okay, I'm generally very protective of this film, not just because I really like it, but also because it came to me via a misunderstanding. I'd heard so much about the terrifying legacy of this film that when I finally got the chance to watch it for the first time, I literally thought I had rented the wrong movie. I'd been primed for a film about corporeal desecration, monstrous violence, a grotesque othering of the human body. But the majority of Freaks isn't spent contemplating the horrors of bodily desecration. It's spent getting to know the members of the circus, their routines and personalities, their dynamics and desires. It's not sensational or horrific. It's downright quotidian. I learned a new word for this video, quotidian. It means like everyday and commonplace. Venus and Frozo have a cute little will-they-won't-they romance that eventually blossoms into a full-blown engagement.
Yeah, it's the first time you've ever done that.
Ain't the first time I felt like doing it.
Angelina and Martha share a drink while they discuss Hans and Cleopatra's courtship. Venus and Frida hang laundry together. Frozo compliments Schlitzie's dress.
Oh, Schlitzie, what a pretty dress. Oh, how beautiful you look tonight.
Violet gets engaged to the owner of the circus, which results in one of my favorite jokes of the whole movie.
Violet and he are engaged to be married.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, and you must come to see us sometime.
Thanks. And you must come to come to see us sometime, too.
Come to think of it, almost every character gets at least one introductory joke that references their disability. But what's worth noting here is that none of the jokes are ever at the expense of the performer. They're only ever at the expense of whoever has trouble adjusting to their disability.
I think she likes you, but he don't.
There's a demystification process going on here, a familiarization. When society isn't compounding their problems through prejudice, these people are basically dealing with the same sorts of problems as anyone else. We probably spent about half the total runtime of this 64-minute film just seeing what the lives of all the performers are like. This isn't horror, it's a domestic drama.
Why is it? We women always has got to worry.
Oh, it's always been that way. I guess it always will be.
As film scholar Angela Smith writes in her 2012 book Hideous Progeny, Disability, Eugenics, and Classic Horror Cinema, the narrative proceeds as an effort to domesticate the freaks in their anomalous bodies. Our sympathy lies increasingly with the freaks, the targets of the prejudice, greed, and criminal actions of the physically attractive but morally monstrous Cleo and Hercules. If classic horror film narratives typically dramatize the monster's threats to healthy marriage and reproduction, Freaks portrays the freaks as representatives of such normative practices. Going further still, Freaks consistently blurs the line between abled and disabled. More from Angela Smith. The Freaks' radical differences in size, shape, movement form, mannerisms, and speech patterns disintegrate any coherent notion of freakishness. Moreover, the category of natural or congenital impairment is contested by freaks whose aberrance seems constructed. The bird girl is merely a woman of unusual appearance. Josephine Joseph's intersex status is conveyed primarily through clothing, makeup, and hairstyle. And while Olga Roderick, the bearded lady, may have been the genuine article, many such performers were in fact men impersonating women. There are several characters in the film where you'll watch it and you'll go, "Why are they in the circus again?" Like, I know Roscoe's got a stutter, and I'm not saying that people don't experience terrible discrimination over that, but even in the circus, they're like, "That's not enough. We gotta dress you in historical drag, too."
I did, but it's the bull that needs the bath.
And while Frozo the clown may seem able-bodied at first glance, he has this enigmatic line about halfway through the film which leaves the precise nature of his body unclear.
"You're a pretty good kid."
"You're darn right I am. You should have caught me before my operation."
What I like about this line is the deliberate ambiguity. For all I know, the full explanation was simply cut for time, or to appease the censors, but ultimately, it underscores the point that nobody can be diagnosed on sight. The extent of anyone's abilities, or disabilities, is nobody's business but theirs. I've heard several disability activists say that one of the most common forms of bigotry exhibited against the disabled community is when disabled people's voices, perspectives, and opinions about their own bodies are second-guessed or even silenced by able-bodied people who've somehow decided that they know better. Whereas Freak seems to go out of its way to suggest that people of every shape and size should be able to go about their days without all that policing. Not that everything is so clear-cut. There's an undeniable tension present within these lingering shots of various performers doing random everyday tasks, like when Prince Randian, who performed under the stage name The Human Caterpillar, rolls cigarettes with his mouth, or when Frances O'Connor picks up glasses with her toes. Is the film simply trying to humanize them? Or are we being invited to gawk? I think this tension is best summed up, again, by Angela Smith. On the one hand, the scene's separation from narrative flow emphasizes their status as disability spectacle. We are conscious that our attention would not hold if normal bodies were carrying out these daily tasks. On the other, the lack of sensationalism and the very normal and quotidian nature of the scenes reminds us, by contrast, of the excessive framing that usually surrounds extraordinary bodies. So on the one hand, these shots could be considered a form of disability spectacle, in which disabled people are shown overcoming their disabilities in ways that are meant to impress or inspire able-bodied people, which actually goes to undermine that intent by suggesting that disabled people are only worthy of consideration and accommodation if they're somehow extraordinarily talented, which they shouldn't have to be. It doesn't help that Todd Browning's own promotional statements about the film were pure garbage. He switched into pure Carnival Barker mode, stating in one interview, "Most dwarves come from the Carpathian Mountains in Austria, where some climatic or other condition seems to affect the ductless glands of the body in a way that arrests growth." Which is all hogwash. Just to be clear, he was making it up. Most of the promotional materials were pretty horrendous, come to think of it. Just look at some of these taglines. Ooh. Seriously. Yikes. And while at least two cast members maintain friendships with Browning later in life, namely Johnny Eckhart and Angelo Rosito, most of the performers did no publicity for the film or even mentioned it in their own memoirs or promotional materials. And at least one cast member, Olga the Bearded Lady, told the New Yorker that the film was an insult to all freaks everywhere. Even Johnny Eckhart came to resent the mobs of fans who'd drop in on him unannounced throughout the 1980s. So far be it for me to tell anyone whether or not this film represents good representation. I can't make that call. All I can do is tell you what I get from it. Personally, I don't think these shots mean anything in isolation, and different viewers will inevitably walk away with different interpretations. But within the greater context of the film, which goes to great lengths to normalize the so-called freaks and to get the audience to empathize with them, I can't imagine that these shots were included solely for the audience to gawk. Consider the fact that we never actually see any of the circus performers actually performing in the actual circus. We see them coming on and off stage, getting in and out of costume, and rehearsing their acts, but we never see anyone performing for a paying audience, as if the film is patently rebuking the idea that these people's mere existence constitutes some form of spectacle.
Oh, I'm sorry, Slitzy.
Wait, I take that back. We do see two people performing. This is why I sort of hate it when people show the so-called Google Gobble sequence out of context. It's meant to catch the uninitiated viewer off guard and sensationalize the bodies of these so-called freaks, because without any context, that's all that anyone ever pays attention to. This scene is horrifying, but not because of anyone's disabilities. The horror comes from Cleopatra's rejection of Hans and his created family, the betrayal and humiliation, not to mention the looming threat to poor Hans's life. At this point, we've spent about two-thirds of the film's runtime coming to love and understand this community of outsiders, and the ruthless disregard for their safety and trust is just so tragic, so heartfelt, and humanizing, and I don't think it deserves to be represented any other way.
What, are you a man or a baby?
What I'm getting at here is an important aspect of all cinema, but especially when it comes to classifying horror films, the question of, who do we identify with? If the disabled characters are supposed to be the monsters in this film, why are they presented as protagonists? Now, to be fair, there is always some identification with the monster in every horror film. I mean, who doesn't want to get over a breakup by testing out your new telepod on a massive bender? But in this film, our sympathy is never not with the freaks, even in the last 10 minutes, which is the only part of the film that could ever be called a horror anyway. As Angela Smith writes, in the mute and menacing attack on Cleo and Hercules, the freaks finally conform to generic requirements by becoming dumb and violent monsters. Freaks thus conforms to horror convention by finally presenting its unusually embodied figures as primitive, animalistic, and violent. But see, look. Finally. She says it twice. If Freaks ever becomes a horror film, it's only, finally, in the last 10 minutes. In fact, I've never heard anyone try to suggest that Freaks is a horror film before the final reel. And just because the movie ends with an act of horrific violence doesn't automatically make it a horror film. See, in most horror movies, there's usually some monster running around that represents a primordial id which must be repressed in order to restore order. But who even is the monster here? Some have suggested that it is indeed the eponymous freaks, as made manifest by their animalistic attack on the ideal of feminine beauty. But personally, I think that's a deliberately surface-level interpretation that you could only claim if you had only seen the last 10 minutes of the film, or that Bravo special. Anyone who watches the whole movie knows that Cleopatra's the one who's behaved like a monster. She's the transgressive threat to society that must be repressed in order to restore order. And it's not just that the film ends with a shocking act of transformative violence. It's that that violence is largely justified, defensive, retributive, even. Angela Smith, once again, by presenting this act of violence at the end of the narrative arc as a logical, if not justified, action resulting from the monstrous violences of normal people, the film demands that its viewers rethink monstrosity as something created rather than inborn. By the end of the film, we've come to appreciate the in-group that these performers have created for themselves, and we want to see it protected at all costs. It's certainly poetic, turning Cleopatra into a one-woman sideshow, but it lacks the despair, the nihilism, and the unfairness that usually accompanies such acts of climactic violence. In a word, the violence here doesn't feel horrific. It feels heroic. Get his ass. This identification with the freaks, and the subsequent justification of their self-determination through an act of spontaneous violence, is in itself kind of revolutionary for this genre, and I'm arguing not even possibly accidental, seeing as how Freaks was made at the very height of the formal eugenics movement within the United States. Part 4. I guess it's finally time to talk about eugenics. Now, this isn't a video about the history of the eugenics movement, but no video about freaks would ever be complete without at least a quick primer. Eugenics was, and still is, the belief that society is filled with certain undesirables who need to be prevented from breeding in order to better the human race as a whole. Policymakers took aim at absolutely everyone, from the mentally ill, to the chronically ill, to the disabled, petty criminals, ugly people, even the indigent, or people without homes. And the movement was way more popular than you might think. From hideous progeny, eugenic associations counted among their members and supporters President Theodore Roosevelt, inventor Alexander Graham Bell, Stanford University President David Starr Jordan, director of the American Museum of Natural History Henry Fairfield Osborne, and the Eugenics Record Office's managing director Harry Hamilton Laughlin, who eventually became an advisor to the House Committee on Immigration and Naturalization. The policies proposed and even occasionally adopted by these eugenicists included everything from banning marriages between people with disabilities, anti-miscegenation laws, and even fining couples who give birth to blind, insane, or epileptic children. Fining them! The Second International Congress of Eugenics took place in 1921, the Immigration Act of 1924 specifically targeted non-white immigration, and in 1927, the Supreme Court upheld the state of Virginia's compulsory sterilization of Carrie Buck for her so-called feeble-mindedness. And besides all this material destructiveness, the whole movement was also tinged with this condescending, paternalistic, "this hurts me more than it hurts you" vibe, like it was the white, able-bodied rich man's burden to make sure that the lower classes didn't outbreed the so-called better elements of the human race. E.R. Johnstone summed up the mission and mindset of the movement way back in 1916 when he said, "When we view the number of the feeble-minded, their fecundity and their lack of control, the menace they are, the degradation they cause, the degeneracy they perpetuate, the suffering and misery and crime they spread, these are the burden we must bear." It was really only with the rise of the Nazis in the mid-1930s that overt eugenic policies finally fell out of fashion in the United States. But just to be clear, eugenic ideology is still very much around. All of the policy goals are still here. The 1920s was merely the height of the movement back when it was still calling itself eugenics. So as we saw earlier, audiences heaped praise and box office glory on film after film featuring disabled and disfigured characters committing horrible acts of violence all throughout the 1920s. But when the disabled characters were suddenly portrayed by actual disabled people, audiences balked. What does that say about society? Well, no one can say for sure, obviously, but what I'd like to suggest is that it might have had less to do with the presence of disabled actors in the film, and more to do with the fact that Freaks centers their concerns instead of their able-bodied counterparts. In most other body horrors that came before, disabled characters were often the main characters, sure, but they were almost exclusively villains. But then along comes Freaks, a film that regularly bodies eugenic ideology, makes it drink OJ after brushing its teeth. Our first introduction to the Freaks is an explicit condemnation of the eugenic imperative, when groundskeeper Jean leads the owner of the estate into the woods to try and expel them.
Oh, monsieur, there must be a law in France to smother such things at birth, or lock them up. If I say you won't shoot, go away, all of you!
But when the estate owner finally gets a good long look at him, he just decides he's gonna leave him alone.
Please, forget what was said, madame. You are welcome to remain. Au revoir. Come, Jean.
And what's more, Freaks doesn't just humanize and demystify the disabled, but their sex lives as well. Olga the Bearded Lady has a baby with Peter the Human Skeleton.
Ain't it cute? What is it?
A girl.
Oh, boy, that's great, and it's gonna have a beard.
Venus and Frozo get engaged. Violet and Daisy are married to two different men, and then their husbands have to navigate the subsequent logistics of family visits. And of course, Hans is finally reunited with Frida at the end of the film, presumably to marry and have kids of their own. A eugenic text would seek to highlight the strangeness or even the danger of these people's attempts to breed. But Freaks explores their love lives with a delicate touch and mines their relationships for warmth and humor rather than revulsion and horror.
Did you see him? He was out there again tonight.
He followed you from the last town.
I know it, and if Eddie sees it, there'll be a fight.
Freaks also highlights the highly constructed nature of disabilities. It's not that these people are inherently broken or defective. They all do just fine within the world of the circus. Their disability status is largely dependent on the society in which they live. The repeated point throughout the film is that these performers' disabilities are not the problem. It's that the world refuses to accommodate them. This is resoundingly anti-eugenic logic, the idea that disabilities are not innate, but rather a result of societal disinterest and neglect, with the implication being that what's needed is not to sweep these people under the rug, or say, prisons and asylums, but to simply make accommodations for them within society at large. Or not even accommodations, really. Sometimes people literally just need to get out of the way. Even the ending, when Cleopatra is permanently disfigured, can be interpreted as a challenge to eugenic dogma. Now, to be fair, some scholars have suggested that the ending actually reinforces the ableist notion that disabled people are inherently dangerous or violent. But again, I think this is a decidedly surface-level reading, devoid of any of the greater context. In addition to all the other tropes that are being reworked here that we've already talked about, the ending can also be interpreted as a challenge to the idea that being one of society's undesirables is fixed from birth. Our bodies are forever mutable. Anyone can become disabled at any time. You could even go one step further. Given the inevitable ravages of time, absolutely everyone is going to become disabled at some point. It's the most selfish reason I can think of for anyone to ever give a shit, but if that's what you need in order to give a shit... Freaks offers the viewer the chance to be included within the sphere of the monstrous. Or at the more quotidian level of disability, Freaks asks viewers to consider themselves vulnerable to bodily transformation and to the social and scientific opprobrium directed at unusual forms. Eugenics had already reached the almost comically ludicrous endpoint of its inevitable logic way back in 1928, when the American Eugenics Society claimed that only about 4% of all Americans are high grade, with ability to do creative work and be fit for leadership. 4%! As Angela Smith puts it, such assertions indicated the artificiality of the increasingly elusive norm against which individuals were measured, as well as eugenics' creation of a powerful elite on the backs of a growing class of Americans deemed inferior or deviant. See, eugenics isn't really about producing a master race. It's about consolidating power, and as such, its mission will never be complete. There will always be more people to exclude. If you haven't been excluded yet, it's only ever a matter of time. Part 5. Reappraising Freaks. MGM made at least one serious attempt at shutting down production on Freaks. All the actors were originally allowed to eat in the studio commissary, but there was apparently one instance in which none other than F. Scott Fitzgerald stopped by and got freaked the ever-loving fuck out by Violet and Daisy, which eventually led to the studio isolating the disabled cast members in their own tent for the rest of production. Apparently the F in F. Scott Fitzgerald stood for Freak the Ever-Loving Fuck Out. A group of producers eventually asked studio boss Louis B. Mayer to shut production down, but producer Irvin Thalberg, which is the guy who had originally greenlit the project, he stood by Browning and offered to take full responsibility for the potential failure of the film. And so Freaks was finally completed after about 9 weeks of shooting in December of 1931. The original cut was about an hour and a half long, but then various state censorship boards demanded nearly half an hour of cuts, which Browning wasn't permitted to make himself. The final film is a short, breezy 64 minutes, and it definitely feels like there are some pieces missing. The cuts barely appeased the censors, though. England straight up banned it until the early 1960s, and MGM wound up pulling the film before it completed all of its domestic engagements. Even though it did eventually earn back its budget at the worldwide box office, grossing $341,000 on a $310,000 budget, the film was still considered a massive commercial and critical disappointment. Contrary to popular belief, Browning did continue to direct, although he only made four more films over the next 7 years before finally retiring, and that had more to do with his personal demons than with the lack of success for Freaks. He spent the next 20 years in alcoholic seclusion and died in 1962 at the age of 82, just 1 month after Freaks was screened at the Venice Film Festival to its biggest audience in decades. As for the original camera negative, I seriously doubt that it was dropped into San Francisco Bay, if for no other reason that film stock contains valuable silver which can be extracted for resale. So if anything, it would have been recycled, not dumped. But that's not the end of the story. Freaks underwent a critical reassessment throughout the 1960s when it was rediscovered on the French art house circuit, and one of the first things people started asking was whether or not Freaks was really a horror film. So yeah, I'm about 60 years late to the party in asking this question. I have broken no new ground with this video. I've basically just taken other people's analysis and brought it to YouTube. Ultimately though, I don't think it matters too much which section of Blockbuster you'd ultimately put Freaks in. Film critic Peter Hutchings said that the only reason people call it a horror at all is because no one could think of any other generic category where it might belong. And I think that's true. Ultimately, I think the question is more interesting than any possible answer, because the question itself reflects the themes of the film. Just as Freaks' inclusion of Cleo in the genre of Freaks forces our reconsideration of what it means to belong to a particular and disenfranchised class, the inclusion of Freaks in the horror genre forces our reconsideration of the genre's status. And when people started rewatching the film in the 1960s and asked themselves who they should identify with, it didn't take long for them to land on the Freaks. Central to Freaks' changed reputation was its audience's willingness to identify with the Freaks. Embracing marginality, and opposition to bourgeois social norms, midnight moviegoers saw Freaks as a movie about a persecuted class of people who eventually pool their resources and join forces in order to defeat the cruel oppressors who mock and exploit them. Can't imagine how that's still relevant. Calling all freaks. No, please, no, please, no, please. Calling all freaks.